We humans know in summer, days are longer, and in winter, the nights are longer. It is generally the length of day that gives the most reliable indication of advancing season. We know that roses bloom in summer and chrysanthemums in winter. Flowering is so predictable in plants that it is used as a floral calendar. But how does each of the flowers know that it's time to bloom? How do plants sense the changing in day length? It is possible because of photoperiodism. Photoperiodism is a term coined by Gardner and Allard, combining Greek words for light and duration. Not only did they coin the term, but also discovered photoperiodism after doing experiments on Maryland mammoth, a mutant of tobacco, and concluded that it is the length of the day that was critical in photoperiodism. But it was later discovered that the dark period or the length of the night was the controlling factor. So photoperiodism turns out to be a misleading term, because it implies that plants measure the duration of daylight. In fact, plants measure neither the relative length of the day and night nor the length of the photoperiod. They measure the length of the dark period. Photoperiodism influences many aspects of plant development, such as tuber development, leaf fall, and dormancy. But the control of flowering by photoperiod has attracted the major share of interest. On the basis of photoperiodic requirement for floral induction, plants have been classified under different categories. They are short day plants, abbreviated as SDPs, long day plants, LDPs, and day neutral plants. Short day plants will flower if the day length is shorter than a critical photoperiod. Examples of SDPs are soybean, poinsettia, potato, sugarcane, cosmos, chrysanthemum, etc. Long day plants require a photoperiod of more than a critical length, which varies from 14 to 18 hours. Examples of this category are spinach, lettuce, radish, alfalfa, sugar beet, larkspur, etc. In day neutral plants, flowering is not affected by day length. Examples of this category are tomato, cucumber, cotton, pea, and sunflower. It is important to understand that the distinction between short day plant and long day plant is not based on the absolute length of day. For example, both xanthium, commonly called as cockleburr, and hyoscyamus niger, commonly called as black henbane, will flower with 12 to 13 hours of light per day. Yet, cockleburr is properly classified as a short day plant and henbane as a long day plant. Whether a plant is classified as a short day plant or long day plant depends instead on its behavior relative to a critical day length. The critical day length for short day plant, xanthium or cockleburr, is 15.5 hours, meaning that it will flower whenever the day length is less than 15.5 hours out of every 24 hours. The critical day length for the long day plant, hyoscyamus or henbane, is 11 hours, and it will flower when the day length exceeds that value. With the help of this diagram, I would like to explain the photoperiodic control of flowering. As you can see in the first case, this is a short day plant that requires long dark periods for flowering. In the second case, decrease in critical periods leads to vegetative state in the short day plant. In third case, a brief flash of light during the dark period inhibits flowering in the short day plant. Some plants are intermediate day length plants. They flower in response to day length of intermediate length, but remain vegetative when the day is too long or too short. So photoperiodism is a response to the length of a dark period. But the length of the dark period is defined by the intervals between photoperiods. In other words, the length of a dark period is determined by the timing of light off and light on signals. In nature, plants are exposed to photoperiodic cycles, which consists of alternate periods of light and dark diurnally. Any photoperiodic cycle which induces flowering in a plant is called photoinductive cycle. On the contrary, the photoperiodic cycle which does not induce flowering in a plant is non-photoinductive cycle. A photoperiodic cycle consisting of 16 hours light and 8 hours dark period generally induces flowering in LDPs. While a cycle consisting of 8 hours light and 16 hours dark period induces flowering in SDPs. The number of cycles required to induce flowering in a plant varies. One short day photoinductive cycle is sufficient to induce flowering in Xanthium strumerium and Farbutus nil, while Salvia occidentalis, a short day plant, may require at least 17 cycles. Some factor responsible for flowering response gets accumulated during inductive cycle. The transition to flowering occurs when vegetative meristems cease indeterminate production of leaves, axillary buds, nodes, and internodes, and instead produce determinate flowers. Many plants sense change in seasons by monitoring photoperiod, the light and dark cycles over a period of 24 hours. The apical meristem are commonly covered by protective juvenile leaves and are thus poor tissues for detecting these changes in light conditions. The photoperiodic signal for floral induction is actually perceived by the leaves. This was demonstrated by the Russian plant physiologist M. Chailakhyan in 1937. In a set of experiments, short day plants, perilla and xanthium could be induced to flower even when all the leaves had been removed, except one leaf which was kept in short day conditions. Xanthium is a short day plant. It will not flower when exposed to long day conditions. All the grafted plants flowered despite being exposed to long days. Only the first plant was exposed to short day conditions. When leaves were taken from the induced plant A and were grafted to non-induced ones B, C, D and E, it resulted in induction of flowering in the non-induced ones. From these experiments, Chailakhyan suggested that the floral stimulus might be a hormone, which could diffuse through graft union. Flowering was observed in non-induced stems, indicating that a signal crossed the graft junction. He called this stimulus as Florigen. He proposed Florigen to be synthesized in leaves and transmitted to the shoot apex. This is a model for the long-distance transport of floral stimulus. The photoperiod is measured in the leaf phloem parenchyma cells, where constant gene is activated by phytochrome and cryptochrome. Activated constant gene induces the transcription of the FT gene. FT protein is translocated through the phloem sieve tube cells to the shoot apical meristem. Once in the meristem, FT interacts with the transcription factors to induce the transcription of flowering genes. In another model given by Davies, constance protein accumulates in the companion cells of leaf phloem under long day conditions and triggers the transcription and subsequent translation of flowering locus T genes. FT protein probably diffuses through plasmodesmata into the sieve elements for long-distance transport and then most likely moves cell to cell also by diffusion through plasmodesmata to the meristem, where it interacts with the FD protein. The FT-FD complex translocates to the nucleus and triggers the expression of several genes, including the floral meristem identity gene, AP1, and thus flowering occurs.